From Liverpool with love for your ears only, I'm David Alpern.
I'm Melissa Axelberth with a quote from the news. The committee's names are never mentioned, ever. That was Tom Sherrack, former president of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, describing the secretive panel that nevertheless comes under great pressure this time of year as it decides which deceased entertainment figures will be mentioned in the farewell feature on Oscar night. Now this.
The city never has witnessed the excitement stirred by these youngsters from Liverpool who call themselves the Beatles.
Close your eyes and I'll kiss you. Tomorrow I'll miss you. Remember, I'll always be.
It was precisely 49 years ago this weekend that the Beatles made their debut on TV's Ed Sullivan Show, winning the imprimatur of that showcase for the best of culture high and low. Scrambling around backstage in the wings and out front was a young photographer named Henry Grossman. Hired to document the event, he began a 4-year friendship with the phenomenal British rock group, visiting their homes, shooting their recording sessions, tagging along on their travels.
Now Grossman has brought back the Beatles he knew so intimately in a spectacular limited edition volume with 1,000 mostly never-before-seen photos. Places I Remember, My Time with the Beatles, and an introduction by Paul McCartney himself. And to talk about the book, the band, and the rest of his extraordinary life as a photographer, actor, and operatic tenor for your ears only, Henry Grossman joins us now. Welcome to the program. As a man whose taste and talent eventually led him to opera, what was your first reaction to the Beatles' music?
Thank you very much.
As a man whose taste and talent eventually led him to opera, what was your first reaction to the Beatles' music?
I didn't understand it. I didn't care for it. I was really listening to symphonic and classical and opera, which I loved. And the music was just, it went right through me, by me. I didn't hook up to it.
Well, they were already
up to them, but not to their music.
They were already celebrities when they first came to America, but did you have a strong sense even then of how much further they would go?
I had no idea how far they would go, and neither did they. I have a tape that I made at George's home later on, and he said to me, Henry, who knows how long this is going to last? And that was almost 50 years ago.
When I covered the Beatles at Shea Stadium in New York, the teen fan frenzy drowned out all but the band's opening chords, and I found it almost scary. What was your reaction to that kind of reaction?
Wow. My reaction was to reach into my pockets and take some Kleenex out and stuff it in my ears. the first concert I heard them at was in Atlantic City, and I have a picture I took in Atlantic City of a policeman standing in front of the stage with his hands in his ears, because the screaming was so loud, I couldn't hear the music. And even on the Ed Sullivan Show, we could hear because of the broadcast. But in the house, the screaming, I was up in the balcony with some of the kids, young ladies screaming, and it was incredible.
Besides the problem of hearing them, watching them as performers, it was really different from the images that you caught of them creating their music, working it out in recording sessions. I mean, really creating the music. They really seemed to be musicians at heart as well as, popular performers.
I think they were totally musicians rather than popular performers. We put the appellation popular performer and fame, et cetera, to them, but they were musicians, no question. Paul walked into, in my first book called Kaleidoscope Eyes, starts with Paul walking in at the in one evening at the Abbey Road, sitting down at the piano and playing a few notes and then saying, hey guys, listen to this. And they all gathered around the piano to listen. And they started working that night on that, I think it was Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. The thing was, there was no music written out. They didn't have, they were creative and kept it in their mind, kept the music in their mind and changed it. I went over to John's house with George, and I have pictures in the book, in this new book, of John and George playing on their guitars for themselves, just playing. And as a matter of fact, another picture that excited our publisher was I have a picture of John sitting on a sofa watching a TV, only the TV sound was off. And John said he often sits in front of a TV with the sound off and composes his songs. So they're musicians, no question.
What do you think was it about you that led them to be so open with you, to make you their favorite photographer?
I don't know. I think, well, first of all, I was near their age. I was maybe three or four or five years older than they were. And I may have had something to offer, having traveled around a bit and met a lot of people. But I also wasn't demanding anything of them, asking anything of them. I became a friend. And when we were in Austria, George asked me if I could, when we get back to London, could I come over and photograph some pictures, take some pictures of him and Patty, which I did. And from there, we started going over to John's house and then another time to Ringo's house. And so I was not posing them, so to speak. I remember one of my favorite pictures is of George sitting at breakfast in Nassau. We were all at the breakfast table. I had my camera with me. I wasn't taking pictures of I was having breakfast. But George came and sat down, and I looked at him and reached for my camera, and I said, George, I've got to take this picture. If you don't like it, we'll kill it. But I took it, and it's to me, it's one of my favorites. What I would expect Hamlet to look like. There's a wonderful vulnerability. He's not posing for me. He's seeing me.
Henry Grossman's new book is Places I Remember, My Time with the Beatles, in limited edition with 1,000 photos from Curvebender Publishing. There's also that earlier book, Kaleidoscope Eyes, with photos from one night spent with the Beatles as they worked on Sgt. Pepper. His website is henrygrossman.com. And this has been For Your Ears Only.